Greetings, friends and loved ones at Lewisham and Dunham. I'm so pleased to be with you, and I would like to thank the pastoral leadership of Pastor Kwating and the elders for inviting me to be part of this, this series, The Messiah, Christ, a prophecy, Christ, the Messiah in the pandemic. This has been a wonderful series so far, and I'm pleased that today, from Ontario, I can also be part of this exercise. My assignment is to talk about Jesus, the Passover Lamb. Jesus, the Passover Lamb. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you so much for what you continue to do for us. We pray that you will speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Right from the beginning of sin, when Adam and Eve sinned, God had to kill a lamb to cover their nakedness. And so right from Eden, when man fell, God had to cover up our nakedness. God had to look after us. And so it is that when Abraham as well, when God had a covenant with Abraham, fast forward, God had a covenant with Abraham, and God told him that he is going to choose him as his seed will be a chosen generation, a new nation that was going to proclaim the glory of God all over the world. And so Abraham was called one day, and God asked him to go and sacrifice his son. And so Abraham, we know, Mount Moriah, Abraham went there and he tied his son. His son asked him, "Father, now we have everything, but where is the lamb?" And Abraham told Isaac in Genesis 22, he says, "God himself will provide for himself a lamb." And we know the story right there on Mount Moriah, what happened. Now, Israel, God chose his people. Israel went into bondage in Egypt. And we know the story, how they got there and what over the years, several hundreds of years after that. Now they were in bondage because of their obedience. They were in bondage because of their, you know, disobedience to God and his dictates. And now they were in so much trouble that God decided to save his own children from freedom into, from captivity into freedom. And so God used Moses. Moses who had run away to the desert. Moses got that, who had run away to the desert and spent 40 years. God shaped him. And Moses came back. We know the story right there. And so Moses came to the Pharaohs asking them that, "Let my people go." That's the message from God, that let the people of Egypt leave. People of Israel leave Egypt so that they can go to the promised land. But Pharaoh, knowing that his economy will tank, knowing that this will not be good for him, decided, "Nope, I'm not letting them go." And so one plague after the other, we know the story. Pharaoh said, "No way, they are not going." And so now this was the ultimate thing that God was going to do. The final plague was going to be the death of the first male of the people of Egypt. And here God shared with Moses and Aaron that, "Listen, go to the people," and he told them go to the people and instruct them about this, that they are supposed to take a lamb, and that lamb was supposed to be killed. That lamb was supposed to be 1 year old. That lamb was supposed to be without blemish. And that lamb was supposed to, each family was supposed to kill a lamb representing the family. And so they were given these instructions in Exodus chapter 12. And in Exodus chapter 12, they were given these instructions. And God says, you know, he told them that, "Listen, make sure that this lamb will represent." And then after the lamb has been killed, after the lamb spends a few days with you, examine the lamb, and then the lamb will be killed. And said, "Look, this, use the blood of the lamb as the doorpost, and use it to use the blood as a signpost on the lintel and the doorpost of your door, so that when the angel comes over, the angels will pass over your house, your home. And so that is the genesis of the story of Jesus, the Passover lamb. Passover started right from there in Exodus chapter 12, when the people understood and the people obeyed and they did this. Yes, that night came that God passed over the children of Israel. There was wailing and gnashing of teeth. Many died. Firstborn son of Pharaoh died, and several of the Egyptian families were wailing, whereas the people of Israel, they were all spared. God was about to wreak judgment on the people of Egypt, and so he told the people of Israel that make sure that you put the blood. It is the blood. Put the blood on the lamppost. And then when I see the blood, when I see the blood, in Exodus chapter 12, verse 13, it says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And so this is what happened. And the people of Israel were saved. And that was the beginning of their journey right from Egypt to the promised land. And over and over again, God used blood sacrifices to tell and to show the people that yes, this is something that has to be done. But if you look at it, the lamb had to be chosen. The lamb must be young, verse 3 and verse 5. The lamb had to be without blemish, spotless. The lamb had to be male, and the lamb had to be eaten. And the lamb, there was, you know, this was something that the lamb was to be led the lamb was to be slaughtered. And so Jesus fulfilled all, checked all these things. Jesus Christ checked all these things. And so John, in John chapter 29, saw this and said, oh, behold the Lamb of God. John 1:29 says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. But before then, even Jesus' own birth, Jesus' own birth even indicated that yes, he surely is the Lamb of God. Yes, he surely is the Passover Lamb. Jesus was born in a manger. And the manger was where, you know, lambs were born. And privileged lambs were born. And so here he was, the Son of God, God allowing him and orchestrating it that so that he will be born in a manger. And so all throughout by the Bible, we see this. And so it was that John saw him coming. John says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Seeing Jesus, he saw Jesus as the Lamb of God. And so it is. When you fast forward, we know that Jesus was killed. We know that Jesus was without blemish. He was born of Virgin Mary. Jesus wasn't born like you and I. And so Jesus was without blemish. And so it was only God who could do this for you and I. And so what happened? Imagine that from Genesis, right from when we sin, right to Revelation, when the angels were shouting, thousands of angels, who is worthy? They said, it is the blood. Worthy is the lamb that was slain. And so Jesus's death on Calvary cross was so important to us. His death was so important. But Isaiah said that he will be led like a lamb to the slaughter in Isaiah 53 verse 7. That Jesus, the Lamb of God, will be led like a lamb to the slaughter. And that is exactly what happened. So when John saw him before he was even baptized, he says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And Paul in 1 Corinthians 5:7 says that Jesus, Paul declared that Christ is our Passover lamb and he has been sacrificed. The Passover lamb has been sacrificed. And so it is. So somebody will ask the question, Pastor, so what? I'm glad you asked. I'm glad you asked that question, because all these things, right from Genesis to Revelation, Jesus has been seen throughout history. He has been seen, and it has been declared. It has been said by the prophets. It's been prophesied and has been fulfilled. And we know for a fact that Jesus is the Lamb of God. And so what? Number one, I want to leave you three things. Number one, Jesus' Christ's sacrifice satisfies the wrath of God. You see, Sin has to be, Ezekiel 18 verse 4 says that the soul that sins, it shall die. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. And without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. There's no forgiveness of sins. In Hebrews 9:22 talks about that. And so here it is, that the blood of Jesus now satisfies the anger or the wrath of God. Sin, a soul that sinned, shall die. Justice demands that you and I die. Justice demands that you and I face the consequences of death. It is, you know, but Hebrews 10:4 talks about it is impossible for the bull, the blood of bulls and ghosts to take away sins. And so it's only the death of God man, it's only the death of Jesus Christ that can take away the sins of the world. And so Jesus said, John verse 1, it talks about that Jesus is the one who takes away the sins of the world. And so the first point I want to leave with you is that yes, Jesus' death satisfies that wrath of God, the justice part. God justice calls for the fact that if you sin, you die. But God is ever so merciful that he is so merciful that he says that, look, you cannot kill this kid. You cannot kill Damson. Why? Because I died for him. And so it is that satisfies the justice part. Mercy, justice and mercy. Justice and mercy. And God satisfies what had to be done. And so it's important that justice demands that you and I die. But mercy said, no, I will die for him. I will die for her. I will die for this child. And so it is that we find that the first point I want to leave with you is that God satisfies the justice demand for the death of us sinners through the death of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus died in our stead. And so Sister White talks about something that is so important. Sister White says in Desire of Ages, page 25, Sister White says that, and I quote, Christ was treated as you and I, as we deserve, that we might be treated as he deserves. He was condemned for our sins in which he had no share, that we might be justified by his righteousness in which we have no share. He suffered the death which was ours, that we might receive life which was his. With his stripes we are healed. What a wonderful Savior. And so he satisfies the need for a blood, the need for blood to pacify the justice aspect. And so mercy was that Jesus was stood in our stead. The second point I want to leave with you is this, that Jesus' blood, the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb, just like we found in Exodus chapter 12, it protects us, it shelters us, it covers us, it covers us. We realize the high price of sin, that sin cost the death of Jesus, God's Son, the Lamb of God. He had to die for you and I. He had to die in our stead. He had to die so that we will be covered. And so the second point is that, yes, he satisfied the justice part. The second point is this, that he covers us. His blood covers us. His blood protects us. His blood shelters us. So we are sheltered under the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Because we are sheltered under the blood of Jesus. And so the songwriter says, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And so Romans 4 says, in Romans 5, 6, and 8, it says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for you and I. While we were yet sinners, Jesus, the Lamb of God, Jesus, the Passover Lamb, died for you and I. And so it is that Christ has made the sacrificial sacrifice so that you and I can be in his stead, that he will stand in our stead and die for you and I. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So all the bulls, all the things that was being done in the sanctuary, in the temple, when Jesus said it is finished, when he died, everything crumbled. All the economy crumbled. That was a significant, important part, was a significant point that Israel and all of us also had to learn, that Jesus is the sacrificial lamb. All these were pointing to that big sacrifice, that ultimate sacrifice that God will make on our behalf. And so his blood covers us. Somebody talked about this blood and talked about the blood coverage, that just like insurance. I know insurance coverage in England in a bit, you know, insurance coverage covers you sometimes. If you have the premium, it covers you for rental and everything. If you get a flat tire, you get your gas, you finish, you get all those things. That is what the blood of Jesus also does. There are some times that we are flattened in our face, but the blood of Jesus covers us, it protects us, it lifts us up, and it helps us to cleans us up, and it sets us on our way. It helps us, it lifts you up from where you are, and it takes you to where you ought to be, his presence. And that is by, if you claim the blood of God, if we reach out to the blood of God, there is that coverage that it gives us. And so sometimes, you have a flat tire, sometimes you just are in a place where you have an accident, that you have sinned, that you have caused so much harm, but the blood of Jesus, all you need to do is dial up to Jesus and say, Jesus, help me, God, and God will dispatch his angels. God will dispatch, sometimes, brothers and sisters in Christ, people to journey beside you, people to help you along your way. And so the second point is this, that the blood covers us. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You see, when we have the coverage of the blood, it provides us with grace and mercy. Grace and mercy, it covers us, covers our sins. It reconciles us to God. It also, our prayers are answered when we have the blood coverage of Jesus. We are blessed by God. We have fellowship with God and we have fellowship with one another. And so that is the coverage that the blood of Jesus does. It shelters us from all the wiles of the devil. As the devil wants to kill and steal and to destroy us, Jesus presents his blood. And through the Holy Spirit's power, we are saved from ourselves most of the time and from the wiles of the devil. That is what Christ, the Passover Lamb, does. He says, when I see the blood, I will pass over. And so when the devil sees the blood of Jesus, when you claim the blood of Jesus, when you claim the coverage of Jesus, the devil has to pass over. The devil has to pass over because you are enveloped and you are under the wings of the Almighty God. What a Savior. What a wonderful God that we serve. And the final point I want to leave with you is this, that he secures our salvation. Hallelujah. He secures our salvation. When Jesus said, "It is finished," our salvation was secured forever. What we ought to do, what we need to do, is to claim and to ask and to come under his kingship, his lordship, and to claim that, "Lord, I want to serve you all the days of my life." And that gives us the opportunity to be called children of God. And so, that is the beauty of the God that we serve. Number one, God he made provision so that justice is served, so that mercy commingles with justice, and Jesus' death now pays for what we deserved. And then secondly, because Jesus died, it covers us, it gives us that coverage, and we are assured of salvation if only we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. And so do you take him as your Savior? Do you claim him as your Savior? And so Jesus said, "I am the way, I am truth itself, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus says, unless one is born, John 3:3, he talks, unless one is born, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Unless you are born again, whoever calls the name of Jesus will be saved. Romans 10:13. And so, my brother, my sister, call on the name of Jesus and you will be saved. Call him and let him be the Lord of your life. Let him be the Passover lamb. Let him be, give you that blood coverage. Let him be the one who satisfies your the justice part so that he will take your place. Let him be the one who will also give you salvation. But if you must believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, believe in him, believe in whoever calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. Romans 10:13 tells us. And so it's important that, you know, because we need to understand that Jesus, because he died, the hymn writer says, God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. And there's an empty grave to prove that my Savior lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, you and I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, we are given a new lease of life. We are given coverage. Because he lives, salvation is assured if we call on the name of Jesus. My brother, my sister, don't wait for too long. Call on the name of Jesus. Don't wait in your sins. Don't think the devil has pushed you so far out that you are out, you are down and out. No. Claim the blood of Jesus. Even in this pandemic, when you seem to be so bogged down, when you seem to be so depressed, when you seem that everything now that's locked down, everything is going haywire, remember the blood of Jesus, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb who gives you coverage. So when you have the blood on the doorpost, he will pass over. The devil will pass over you. When you allow the lamb to cover you, the devil will now pass over you. And so claim Jesus Christ as your Savior, because he's the one who has loved you with an everlasting love. Right from Eden, God protected us, covered us, covered our forefathers, their nakedness, their sinfulness, with the blood. And right when Jesus got to Revelation, tells us from Genesis to Revelation, when the angels were asking who can open the seals, they said only one person, and that is the one who was slain, and that is Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Today, Jesus offers you an opportunity to give your whole life to him. Will you come to him? Will you give him your heart? Will you give him your whole being? Because he's the only one who can lift you from where you are to where you ought to be, his presence. I pray, oh God, I pray for you, my brother, my sister. I pray for young, old, and young adult and children, that you will make your calling and election sure, and make sure that Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, will be your Lord, will be your Savior, and will be the one who will guide you all the way to eternity. Henry Barbos said something that during the Second World War, that he saw a friend in a dugout, and one who had committed so much sin, and a friend was about to die. He said, look, give me your tag so that I haven't committed. My name is clean, so take my name and go and live your life. Jesus has done more than that for us. These friends that Henry Barbos overheard them talking cannot, you know, he can only save them for a little while. But there is eternity that awaits you. There is eternity that awaits you. I don't want you to miss out on that. We have lost so many people in this pandemic, but I don't want you to be lost eventually when you don't make Jesus the Lord of your life. My prayer is that you will make your calling and election sure, that Jesus, the Passover Lamb, will be your Savior. May his name be praised. Shall we pray? Father, thank you so much for loving us and for calling us your own. We thank you so much for what you have done, for what you continue to do. And we thank you so much that even during this series, may we make our calling and election sure. Tonight, thank you for helping us to know that right from Eden, right to the end of the age, you have provided the sacrifice to satisfy the justice, that you have covered us with your blood, that eternity awaits us. All we need to do is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and we will be saved, and that you will help us day by day to live according to your dictates. Thank you for calling us your own. Thank you for helping us to make our calling and election sure. Thank you for calling us your children. We pray and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and God bless you and God bless you. I pray that you will continue loving Jesus, the Passover Lamb. Thank you.